So, my name is Nick Jeffries. I'm an environmental engineer, and I work for an organization called Future Pump. At Future Pump, we are pursuing a seductive but very simple idea, and that is a way of affordably harnessing the sun's energy to pump water. Now, we've been pursuing this idea for many, many years. We've spoken to hundreds of farmers. We've gone through many, many design iterations. We've got very sunburnt. But finally, we have a pump that we feel is ready for the market. The reason we're on Muzinga is that we are setting up our headquarters, Future Pump headquarters for Kenya, on Muzinga Island. Yeah. The original reason we came to Muzinga, decided on Muzinga, was because that was where our first customers lived. But the more time we spent here, we realized that it is a very exciting place. There are so many individuals and organizations working on great projects in the field of permaculture, sustainability, education, and renewable energy. And it's just a great place to be. It's a really fertile place for developing and piloting ideas and also forming positive collaborations. I've only been here for like 3 or 4 days, but just looking into the crowd here, I already see many familiar faces. Yeah. So we're very happy here. We feel very welcome here. So irrigation. Having a way to irrigate your crops, irrigate your lands affordably is a very valuable proposition. Smallholder farmers with less than, say, half an acre, they are sort of the main people we're working with. Their year is split up into the rainy season and the dry season. In the rainy season, farmers generally grow food. They grow maize, millet, sorghum. But in the dry season, if they have access to irrigation, then they're able to grow money, their cash crops. Any surplus vegetables or fruit, you can take to the market, you can sell for money, and then with money, you can buy health, you can buy education, and you can improve the quality of your life. If you're lucky enough to be near to a reliable grid connection, electricity grid connection, then my advice is to use the electricity. I mean, it's electric pumps are reasonably cheap, and the power from the grid is relatively inexpensive. However, most parts of rural Kenya, rural Africa, you don't have a reliable grid connection. I mean, even in the cities, you don't have a reliable grid connection. So the options you have are a labor-intensive manual method, such as a rope and bucket, a hand pump, or a rope and washer pump, or an expensive money-guzzling motor pump. When I came over to the island on Wednesday, I was waiting at the ferry terminal, waiting for my ferry to Mbita, and as I often do when I'm in the country, I went to speak to some of the farmers who were cultivating their plots near to the ferry terminal. The first farmer I spoke to had about 800 square meters of tomatoes. And I asked him, so how do you irrigate? Yeah. How do you irrigate your tomatoes? And he said, well, I've got a petrol pump, and every week, maybe once or twice a week, I put about 6 liters of petrol into the petrol pump, and that's how I irrigate. So I went to see his neighbor, and his neighbor was a younger farmer. And he had about, a couple hundred square meters of cabbages. I asked him, how do you irrigate your crops? He said, you see those two buckets over there? Yeah, pretty big buckets. He says, I take them down to the lake. Lake's about 50 yards away. And then I carry them up and I put them on, I put them on my cabbage plants. So how long does that take you? Yeah, maybe about 2 or 3 hours every day. Like, that's backbreaking stuff. So aside from the obvious question, which is, why doesn't Mr. Cabbage ask Mr. Tomato if he can borrow his pump? There's the other question. Can we provide an alternative to Mr. Tomato from his money-guzzling motor pump, or an alternative to Mr. Cabbage for his back-breaking buckets? And that's what we're trying to do at Future Pump. We're trying to come up with an affordable solar irrigation pump. Now, our design criteria for the pump are as follows. It needs to be affordable. It needs to produce enough water to grow a decent amount of crops. It needs to be robust. Equipment, you know, such as pumps, they get thrown around quite a lot, you know, on the farms around here. And so it needs to be strong. It needs to be easy to set up and move around. It needs to be easy to operate and easy to maintain. So we feel if we can produce such a device, the benefits are numerous. You free up time, which you can use for more productive means. Now, in my journeys around the farms of the world, an observation I've made is that quite often it is the women and children that are lifting and carrying the water. And that, you know, they should be looking after their kids or they should be at school. It reduces the cost of farming, and so you get more profit. You know, who doesn't want more money from their work? It improves food security. It extends your growing periods. And it makes farmers more resilient, not only to fluctuations in oil prices, which affects petrol and diesel, but also to the vagaries and unpredictable weather patterns associated with climate change. So the pump that you see, I don't know if anyone can see the pump down here, but for the purposes of the people at the back, here is a picture of the pump. This pump has undergone, the pump you see down here is at the long line of a number of design iterations. In 2010, I was in Ethiopia. I lived and worked for 3 months with farmers in Ethiopia with the grandparent of this pump. It was a pretty cool looking thing. It had a big, it was actually a steam pump rather than an electric pump. It had a big, shiny parabolic dish. This dish tracked the sun, hence the name sunflower, and it produced steam, and then the steam powered the pump mechanism. It was a beautiful thing to behold. I mean, I loved it, and it looked good, and it sounded good, but you watch the farmers using it, and you got the sense they were struggling a little bit. They found it a little bit too fiddly. It's a little bit dangerous because you're using high-pressure steam, and also it's not so flexible. It's a fixed pump. You can't move it around, and there are issues associated with that. And so we went back to the drawing board, and this is a key part of the design development of the sunflower pump. We're making prototypes. We're putting them in the field. We're getting farmers to use them. We're doing field tests. We're looking and talking to the farmers about their experiences of the pump. And then we take back all the knowledge that we know, that we find out, and then we put it into improving the pump. And we feel now, after many, many, many years, we've got a pump that's ready for sales. In fact, we've had started selling. So let me talk you through the pump. So the pump is powered by a PV panel. It's a direct drive, so the panel generates electricity and then drives a DC motor. It doesn't have a battery, which can be expensive, and batteries don't last, you know, only last for a few years. But also, there are secondary benefits. So when you're not pumping, you can charge your mobile phone or your other electrical devices. Like all pumps, it has an inlet and an outlet. The inlet you put into your water source. Your water source can be up to 6 meters deep. The outlet you can connect to either a sprinkler, a drip irrigation system, or a storage tank. If you connect to a storage tank, obviously there's more flexibility in how you can use the water. For example, you can use the water when the sun's not shining. The yield of the pump depends on the depth of the water, how far above the pump your fields are, and the distance of your fields on your pump. But on average, under average conditions, we find we're pumping about 1,000 to 1,200 litres an hour, which translates to about 8,000 to 10,000 litres a day, which you should be able to irrigate a decent-sized plot. So I'm going to tell you a little bit more our work on Rusinga. What we one of the criteria that we've applied to this pump, the development of this pump, is affordability. And one of the key metrics for affordability is payback time. Can farmers grow enough crops in a year to pay back the cost of the pump? You know, about a year. A year is a sort of a good thing to aim for. And so, to demonstrate this, we partnered with a local NGO, the Rusinga Island Organic Farmers Association. You heard Dennis talking earlier, and by the way, I visited his house yesterday, and what he says about his banana tree with the grey water is true. The grey water banana is up here with a bunch of bananas like this big, and the rain-fed one is like that and doesn't have any fruit at all. It's amazing. It's a really good experiment. And so with Reoffer, we're creating a model farm. Like, we'll have a typical plot, say 600 or 800 square meters, and we're going to see how much crops we can grow in a year or in a harvest. Now, I mentioned a figure earlier, 8 to 10,000 liters a day. That sounds like a lot of water, but actually, with the conditions on Rusinga Island, high solar intensity, very windy, evaporation rates are very high, and so the crops are pretty thirsty. And so, with the help of Reoffa, we're going to be adopting permaculture and water-efficient principles to try and make best use of the available resources and also to get a bumper crop. So I guess the idea is that farmers, they come along, they see our pump working, they maybe buy a pump, but they also get the knowledge of sustainable agricultural principles transferred to them. Someone once said, the most powerful thing in the world is not an army, it's not a king, but it's an idea whose time has come. When the farmers need irrigation the most, when the sun is shining. So why not use the sun to pump water? Thank you very much.